Once again, a very good morning to you. Thank you for joining us for our time of prayer and our time of the sharing of the word. As usual, we're going to firstly go to the word of the Lord, in fact, to the prayer time, I should say, with Pastor Nikki Apenteng, and she's going to be leading us in a short time of intercession. Enjoy the prayer.
Thank you very much. Good morning. Let me greet every one of you in the name of Jesus Christ. Amen. I thank God for this time. I thank God for this season. I thank God for this second semester. At the beginning of the second semester, at the beginning of half of the year, I say, Lord, we are so grateful to you. Today, I feel like praying with you with Psalm 34. Psalm 34, we're going to start from verse 1. It's saying, I will bless the Lord at all times. His praise shall continually be in my mouth. My soul shall make its boast in the Lord. The humble shall hear of it and be glad. Oh, magnify the Lord with me, and let us exalt his name together. But David is saying to us right now, let us bless the Lord. He said, I will bless the Lord at all times. You know, when David is saying this word, it doesn't necessarily mean that wherever he was comfortable. It doesn't matter. It doesn't necessarily mean that wherever he was, everything was smooth with him. But David, in every situation, he said, I will bless the Lord. He is so determined to bless the Lord. He is so determined to praise the Lord. He said, his praises shall continually be in my mouth. Today and this morning, I pray that let his praises be continually in our mouth. The praises of God when time is good, the praises of God when time is bad. In sicknesses and no sicknesses, let us praise the Lord. Let us bless the Lord. Can we pray right now? My Father, my Lord, in the name of Jesus, mighty God, as we're coming before you, Lord, we bless your name. We bless your name for who you are. We bless your name for being our God. We bless your name for being our master. We bless your name for being the great I am. You are Alpha, you are Omega. You are the beginning and the end. Mighty God, you are the Ancient of Days, even at this particular time. And we say thank you for being our Father. We say thank you for being our Lord at a time like this, mighty God. In the name of Jesus Christ, we pray. Amen. Verse 4, I sought the Lord and he heard me and delivered me from all my fears. I sought the Lord and he heard me and delivered me from all my fears. That is what David is saying unto us right now. As for David, he chose to seek the Lord. And I pray right now that every one of us at this time, every one of us at this hour, every one of us at this moment, we choose to seek the Lord. And as we seek the Lord, God will hear us. As we seek the Lord, God will deliver us from all our fears. Father, we thank you for delivering us this morning. We thank you, mighty God, for causing us to seek you. And I pray that you give us grace at a season like this. I pray that you give us grace at this challenging time, that we can seek you. We seek you with all our hearts. And as we seek you with all our hearts, you will hear us, almighty God, and deliver us, oh Father. In the name of Jesus Christ, we pray. Amen. And then verse 6. This poor man cried out, and the Lord heard him and saved him out of all his troubles. He cried up to the Lord, and the Lord heard. This morning, I want you to understand that God hears us. God hears our cries. God hears our afflictions. He said to the children of Israel, when he was sending Moses to deliver them, he said to Moses, I've heard their cries. I've seen their afflictions. Even at this particular moment, God has heard us. God has seen our afflictions. The only thing that we have to do is to cry and groan before God. Can we pray right now? My Father, my Lord, we thank you. We worship your name. We thank you, Father God, that at this particular time, as the nation is crying, as your people are crying, as families are crying, as communities are crying, mighty God, you hear us. And even right now, you will hear us, almighty God, and you're going to save us. You're going to deliver us from this trouble. trouble. You are going to deliver us, mighty God, from this pandemic. In the name of Jesus Christ, mighty God, we thank you. We worship your name. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Verse 7, the angel of the Lord encamps all around those who fear him and delivers them. Father, we thank you that even right now, there are angels all around us. There are angels when we are in our houses. There are angels when we are in our homes. There are angels when we walk by the street. There are angels when we are driving our cars. There are angels wherever we are, mighty God. And those angels, they encamp all around us, especially those who fear God, and he deliver us, almighty God. And we thank you for your angels at this particular time. And even this day, even this morning, continue to dispatch your angels, Father, mighty God, in our schools. Continue to dispatch your angels, Father God, in our communities. Continue to dispatch your angels, Father God, in our nation, in our province, at this crucial time of the year. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Okay, thank you. Verse 9. Oh, fear the Lord, you saints. There is no want to those who fear him. The young lions lack and suffer hunger, but those who seek the Lord shall not lack any good thing. That is what God is saying unto us right now. As we seek you, as we seek the Lord, as we come before God, as we find ourselves, as we find God as our shelter, is the word of God is saying, we are not going to suffer. It doesn't matter where you are right now. Even those who cannot be able to get income, even those who are stuck at this particular time, not knowing what to do, today God is saying, the young lion lack and suffer hunger, but those who seek the Lord shall not lack any good thing. We shall not lack any good thing at this time. We shall not lack any good thing at this hour. We shall not lack any good thing in this season. In the name of Jesus Christ, mighty God. Lord, we thank you that at this time, you will be our provider. We thank you that at this particular time, you are the one, Gosiam, who will walk before us. We thank you that at this particular time, you are God who will be our Father. In the name of Jesus Christ, we pray. Amen. And then, let's go again. As we are praying, as we continue praying, verse 15, the eyes of the Lord are on the righteous, and his ears are open to their cry. The face of the Lord is against those who do evil, to cut off the remembrance of them from the earth. The eyes of the Lord are on the righteous, and his ears are open to their cry. If you are a righteous man, it doesn't matter actually who you are, but the eyes of the Lord are upon you. Saints, I want to tell you this morning that the eyes of the Lord are upon us. I want to tell you at this particular time, I want to tell you this season that it doesn't matter, it doesn't mean that God is far from us. It doesn't mean that his eyes are hidden from us. The eyes of the Lord at this particular season, the eyes of the Lord at this particular time are on us. Father, we thank you for your eyes that are upon us. We thank you for your eyes at this particular time. We thank you for your eyes this season that are upon us, almighty God. In the name of Jesus Christ, my heavenly Father, and your ears are open. They are open to our cries. They are open as we call upon your name. They are open, oh my heavenly Father, mighty God, so that you can listen unto us, so that you can listen unto our cries. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Verse 19. Many are the afflictions of the righteous, but the Lord delivers him out of them all. Many are the afflictions of the righteous, but the Lord delivers him out of them all. The Lord delivers us in every area of affliction, in every area that is not right in us. God delivers us from those areas in the name of Jesus. Doesn't matter the hardship. It doesn't matter the sickness, the disease, even right now, even if we are sick at this particular time, the Lord is saying, he delivers us out of them all. God can deliver us from sicknesses. God can deliver us from diseases. There is nothing that is impossible with God. The word of God is saying every knee shall bow down. Those that are in heaven, those that are on earth, those that are under the earth. And even at this particular time, this sickness, this disease that is in you at this particular time, I want you to understand that God can change the situation. I want you to understand that God can deliver you out of that sickness. In Jesus' name we pray. Father, we thank you for your word. We thank you that, Father God, you said, as there are afflictions around us, as we are suffering at this particular time, you said you'll deliver us. You'll deliver us from troubles. You'll deliver us from afflictions. You'll deliver us from sicknesses and disease. There is no sickness that is above you. There is nothing that is above you, Father. Your word is saying nothing is impossible with you. Even right now, that is what you are declaring this day. That is what you are declaring this morning. In the name of Jesus Christ, we pray. Amen. Lastly, verse 20. He guards all his bones. Not one of them is broken. Evil shall slay the wicked, and those who hate the righteous shall be condemned. The Lord redeems the soul of his servants, and none of those who trust in him shall be condemned. I can tell you this time, I can tell you this season, no one, as long as you trust in God, you will never be condemned. And at the same time, your bone will never be broken at this particular time. In the name of Jesus. Father, we thank you that, God, Sam, at this time, our bones will never be broken. We thank you that, mighty God, at this particular time, as long as we trust you, we'll never be condemned. In the name of Jesus, there is nothing that will condemn us. There is no sickness that will condemn us. There is no darkness that will condemn us. There is no Satan, mighty God, that will condemn us. In Jesus' name, mighty God, we pray. Amen. Father, we thank you for your word. We thank you for answering this word. You are the answer, mighty God. You are the one who answers our prayers. And every prayer that we pray this morning, already you have answered us. Every prayer that we pray this morning, already you have heard us, and we say thank you that we'll be waiting for answers in the name of Jesus Christ, my Lord. I thank you. Amen. Thank you. I thank you. I thank God that you have listened. I thank God that you have watched, our prayers, and you pray with me. I say thank you very much. And now, just let me take this time to hand over to the word. Amen.
Hope you enjoyed that prayer, and thank you and welcome back. We are now going to go to the word of the Lord this morning, and I want to use as a title, God's protection over his people. We are in a time when we need the protection of the Lord. We need the cover of the Lord. We are aware that particularly in this part of the country, which is the Eastern Cape, particularly the pandemic is beginning to pick up. And so we are realizing that more and more we need to pray, and more we need to be aware of the protection of the Lord over our lives and pray towards that direction. So today I want to look at the subject of God's protection over his people. Once again, an item of prayer that we prayed on the day 26, and I just want to preach it through so that we see what the Lord will have for us there. Numbers chapter 6, verse number 24 to verse 25. Numbers chapter 6, verse 24 to 25. The Bible says, the Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face to shine on you. The Lord be gracious to you. The Lord turn his face towards you and give you peace. And so this is a declaration of a blessing when you confer a blessing over a people. And it says, the Lord bless you. And of course, it was released in the Old Testament, and released as a blessing over the people of God. We need to realize that it's still relevant because this is the word of the Lord. When the blessing of the Lord is upon us and when the face of the Lord shines upon our lives, It helps us to know that we are under His grace, under His cover, and everything that we desire, everything that we need is taken care of. So may the Lord bless you, and may the Lord cause His face to shine upon you in a time such as this. And may the Lord be gracious to you, and may the Lord turn His face towards you and give you peace. That is the declaration and the blessing I want to release also over your life. Of course, we need the protection of the Lord over various things in our lives. We need God's protection over marriages. We need God's protection over children. We need God's protection over our elderly. We need God's protection over issues of our economy. We need God's protection over our government. We need God's protection in the church, you know, over the church, over various domains of society, all the 7-8 domains of society. We need the protection of the Lord. And so today I just want to focus firstly the protection of God over marriages. Why? Because the family or marriage is the stability or the foundation of society. When marriages go haywire, when marriages, you know, fail, so families fail. When families fail, communities fail. When communities fail, the entire society is failing, and the nation fails, and the world fails, because something went wrong in the family. So we need to pray for marriages. We know that during the lockdowns, you know, starting from the lockdown 5 all the way up to where we are now in South African context, we know that the lockdowns have contributed towards, you know, domestic violences, have contributed towards, you know, people fighting in the homes, even not, maybe not to a point of violence, but really, you know, to a point of not seeing eye to eye, clashing, you know, arguments, annoyance, irritation with each other, etc. And so precisely because, and this is not just between husband and wife, but siblings, you know, family, relatives, precisely because, you know, people have not been sitting in such close proximity for such a long time, you know, in each other's spaces and faces. And so we need to pray. And so what this time has done, and I shouldn't say the lockdown has done this, because really it's not the lockdown, it's just that there were underlying problems all the time that were there, but we did not know that these underlying problems exist. Now this kind of a time which now forces us to be together, to come together, to sit in one place, you know, for a long time, has kind of highlighted what has always been seated in there, the problems that have been running underneath. And so when these get highlighted, there's manifestations of all kinds and manifestations of all sorts. So I want us to look at Matthew 19, just to remind us again the foundations of marriage. Matthew 19, verse 6, the Bible says, "So then they are no longer two, but one flesh. Therefore, what God has joined together, let no man separate." We must understand that marriage comes from God, and that marriage is God's idea. And whatever God has put together, let nothing separate it. It should not be issues that separate it. It should not be circumstances that separate. So I want to talk to married couples to say, for your marriage. Do not allow, you know, COVID-19 to destroy your marriage, you know, because these are the effects of COVID-19. Do not allow COVID-19 to destroy your marriage, to cause your marriage to go into disaster. Fight for your marriage. And the challenges you see, when you see them, deal with those challenges. Be humbled. One of the things that makes marriages, you know, to suffer is lack of humility from the married couples. You find that pride is the one that causes quarrels, because everybody wants to be right. No one is willing to submit to another. And so you need to begin to deal with that pride in your life and say, "Lord, help me to be willing to submit to my husband. Help me to be willing to submit to my wife," because it's submission one to another. It's not one-sided submission. It doesn't work. You know, the Bible tells us submitting one to another in the fear of the Lord. So I want to exhort you in marriages to say, when we, for us to get protection over marriage, we also need to ensure that the foundations of our marriage are correct. And so this is important for you to go even into the foundations of your marriage. How did your marriage come about? What happened in your marriage? What were the reasons that caused you to marry in the first place? Because these things are always tested. When the foundations are destroyed, the Bible says, you know, in Psalms 11 verse 3, when the foundations are destroyed, what shall the righteous do? So it's important to understand that When foundations are shaken, even that which you are trying to build will never be able to stand. So we have to look into the foundations of marriage and pray for God's protection and pray for God's preservation and pray for God's cover. God will protect marriages as long as the parties involved are still desiring to be partnered together. Because when the parties involved have given up, it does not matter how much, you know, we pray for them. It does not matter how much we try to intercede for them. But if they feel that this is the end of the story, then it's the end of the story. But I want to exhort you and say, fight for your marriage. You've come this far already. Don't allow the devil to steal, kill, and destroy. Because the enemy's plan is to steal, kill, and destroy. Find each other in that marriage. No, talk to each other, communicate, find out what is the problem and swallow your pride. Be willing to realize that the time that God has given you with your spouse is not forever. It's important that you understand that it's a short time. It may look like it's long, but it's actually a short time. Of course, I'm not saying staying in an abusive relationship. Of course, I'm not saying, you know, stay in a relationship where you are, you know, mistreated, you know, and all that, and you can no longer be able to bear it. I'm not just saying endure for the sake of endurance, because out of that, that's where, you know, comes, you know, in a femicide. And so we need to be careful of such things. But it's important that when you have done your best, then you know that if your marriage ever fails, you should know that it has failed having tried. You don't just, at the flinch of one little trial, you throw everything away. No, you try. You work at it. And it must be a long journey before divorce, folks. It must be a long way, 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 way over there. You know, you must have tried every means, every method, you know, counseling, you know, pastoral counseling, professional counseling, family counseling, every intervention, everything, friends intervening, everybody, give everybody a chance, give yourself a chance, give your spouse a chance. And of course, in situations where there's crime, the Lord takes his course. That is very clear and simple and straightforward. Where there's assault, the Lord takes his course. We should not be able to stand such things like assault. When there's assault, when all those, if you can forgive each other, great. But if it's dangerous for you to sit in that relationship, you need to involve the law, or you need to step out of that marriage, because it's no longer feasible and it's no longer conducive. So it is important that we fight for our marriages in this season. But number two, we also need to fight for the well-being of our children. We need to ask God's protection and pray that God will protect our marriages, and also pray that God will protect our children. Look at Psalms 127, verse 3 to 5. The Bible says, "Behold, the children are a heritage from the Lord. The fruit of the womb is a reward. Like arrows in the hand of the warrior, so are the children of one's youth. Happy is the man whose quiver is full of them. They shall not be ashamed, but shall speak with their enemies in the gate." Our children are our future in terms of they are our posterity. They are the ones who are going to cause us to be able to move, to be able to flow in the plans and the purposes of God. Our children carry our DNA. They carry the grace of God over our lives. They carry the anointing of God. They are the ones who will do more things than we can ever do. So your children are an extension of yourself. So if your children, you know, are not taken care of, it means your future is not taken care of. So we invest in our children because we see in them the sustainability of the family. We see in them, you know, future generations. We see in them, you know, the ability to bring forth the things we could not be able to bring forth. The Bible says they are like arrows. Blessed is the man whose quiver is full of them. They are like arrows in the hands of the warrior. So are the children of one's youth. Happy is the man whose quiver is full of them. They shall not be ashamed. They will turn the enemy at the gates. Our children have the ability to do spiritual warfare, to fight the good fight of faith. So we need to pray for them. We need to align them. We need to pray for their protection. And we need to guard them and equip them and help them, even in this season, to be able to follow the ways of God and to give them perspective, to say, in the light of what is going on, how do we see, you know, your future? What is happening? Because children have got a question: what's going on? you know, and where is it going to end? What's happening? And so we need to bring answers to say God is in control and God is still in charge. Of course, we know that most of our children, schools are beginning to open up now. We really need to pray for them, pray for their protection, pray for their keeping, that God will cover them, God will preserve them, and God will sustain them. Look at Isaiah chapter 65, verse 20 in the New Living Translation. And this is now focusing on the elderly. We pray God's protection upon the elderly. The Bible says, no longer will babies die when they are only a few days old. No longer will adults die before they have lived a full life. No longer will people be considered old. It says, no longer will people be considered old at 100. Only the cursed will die that young. In other words, you know, at 100, you are still called young. That's the numbering of the Bible. The Bible, the language of the Bible, God calls us young at 100 years old. And so, in other words, we need to pray that God will sustain our parents, that God will sustain the elderly, that God will sustain them so that they would live their full age, full term. It is the will of the Lord that you don't die before your time. The devil is a liar. You need to be able to pray and ask God to protect the elderly, your parents, you know, those who are elderly in our community, so that God will preserve them, protect them until they fulfill their destiny. Yes, they've lived their lives. Some of them are quite elderly and they've lived their lives. But as long as God still wants them here, it means their assignment is not over yet. It means there are certain things, for example, that God keeps you for a reason. He preserves you so that you would see your children's children fulfilling the purposes of God in their lives. And when God takes you, or when he allows you to go, it's because you have reached your end and you have fulfilled your purpose. You have done all your assignment and everything is said and done. And so it is important that we pray that you do not go before your time. It is a very important prayer point to say, Father, preserve us, keep us, your word says. And how do you pray this prayer point? You pray through the word. You say, Lord, your word says that no longer shall, you know, adults die before they have lived a full life. You know, so God wants us to live a full life, a life in abundance, that you live a full life. In other words, no regrets. When you go to your grave, no regrets. Everything you needed to do, you do it. So pray about that to the Lord and ask God for that. Say, Father, I pray that my destiny would be preserved, that I will not exit before time, that I do not regret, that I don't look back. Sometimes it's not even exit, more than it is you find that by the time you need to do certain things, you no longer have the strength or the power to do them, because maybe you are too elderly and these things you could have done them when you were younger. So fulfill all you need to do. Don't procrastinate because you don't know what the future holds. Do everything you must do while you still have breath, while you still have time. Be sure that you fulfill your purpose. You live your full life, the Bible says. We need to also pray around the economy, God's protection around the economy. The Bible says in Exodus 23 verse 25 in the New Living Translation, you must serve only the Lord your God. If you do, I will bless you with food and water, and I will protect you from illness. So God blesses our food and our water, and he does what? He protects us from illness, and he makes sure that we live long lives, we live fulfilled lives. Now, Psalms 132 verse 15 in the New Living Translation says, I will bless this city and make it prosperous. I will satisfy its poor with food. Food, it's a scarce commodity right now for the poor. And we need to really pray that God will bless us. And we use these scriptures to come to the Lord. So you see, when we are talking about God's protection, we're not talking to people, we're talking to God. We're saying, God, you said in your word that you will bless our water, you will bless our food. You said you will protect us from illness. That's what the Bible says in the, you know, Exodus 23, 25 in the New Living Translation. The Lord will bless our food and he will bless our water and he will protect us from illness. These These are the promises of God. So we bring to him his promises. We say, Father, you said in your word. And so you must learn to pray the word of God and bring God's word to him and stand on that word. I bless this city. I will bless this city, says the Lord, and make it prosperous, and I will satisfy its poor with food. Lord, you said you will bless this city. Bless this city. Bless us. Bless me in this city. Bless us so that we have enough food in our area and our territory. Lastly, or one before last, we pray for government. First Timothy chapter 2, verse 1 to 4. We pray that God will protect our government. The Bible says, therefore, I exhort first of all supplications, prayers, and intercessions, and giving of thanks be made for all men, for the kings and all who are in authority, that we may lead a quiet and a peaceable life in all godliness and reverence. So, for this is good and acceptable in the sight of the Lord our Savior, who desires all men to be saved and to come to the knowledge of the truth. So, it's important that we pray for governments. It's important that we pray that God preserves them, that God keeps them, that God sustains them, that God makes sure that they are preserved, they are kept, they are sustained, they are protected in all that they do. This is, or this should be, the attitude of us praying for our government. And we need to watch our words. What negativity? Sometimes we speak negative words, we crush our governments. Be careful of the things you say. Lastly, we're praying for the church. Matthew 16, verse 18, the Bible says, and I also say to you that you are Peter, and on this rock I will build my church, and the gates of Hades shall not prevail against you. So we need to ask God protection for the church. You see, we need to come to the Lord, because the church, if the devil can kill the church, he would do it, you know, he would have done it by yesterday. He can't do that. But yes, the devil can derail the church. Yes, the devil can distract the church. Yes, the devil can hinder the church. And so we need to pray for God's protection over his people. And by the church, we don't mean a building with four walls. By the church, we mean the people of God. The people. And so we need to pray for God's people who believe in God's name, who believe that God has called them and God has sent them. So let us continue to pray for God's protection over families, marriages, homes, the church, the economy of the land, the elderly. Let's lift up our voice and pray. Father, in the mighty name of Jesus, we thank you. Even on this word, help us, Father God, to pray for various sectors of our community, to pray for various segments of the community, to bring your people before you, not to be afraid to bring them, Father God, to be confident, and Lord, to use scripture in praying for various elements, to pray, Father God, for marriages. We pray into marriages, we pray for families, hold families together. Let, Father God, COVID-19 not bring the end of stable homes. We ask, Father God, that you will preserve, in Jesus' mighty name, families and homes to still be preserved and still be in stay in stability. We pray for children, Father God, that they will grow in the ways of God. Father God, let our children not be taken out by this COVID-19. Preserve them in the schools. Preserve them where they are. Preserve their health, because that is the future of our generation. So we pray that you protect them and you preserve them. They are our future presidents, our future doctors, our future lawyers. They are future workers. They are the ones who will make the economy sustainable and working. We ask for your protection over their lives. Father, we pray for the economy of the land. We pray for improvement. We pray for grace, particularly, Lord God, because of the effects of COVID-19. We are aware that the economies of the nations have taken strain. We ask you for favor. We pray, Father God, for the elderly. Protect them, Father God, because we still need them, Father God, to guide, to give guidance to younger generations. We ask you in the mighty name of Jesus. We give you all the praise and all the honor. In Jesus' mighty name, Lord, we thank you and we bless you. Amen. Well, I believe that that has blessed you. And if you've been touched by this word and you want to give your life to Jesus, I want to pray for you right now. Please say these words after me as you give your life to the Lord. Say, Father, in the name of Jesus, I come to you today. I give my life to you. You are my Savior and you are my Lord. Lord, I surrender to you and I pray today, forgive me, wash my sins away, cleanse me, make me your child. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. Xa ufuna ukuthetha ngalamazwi emva kwam, ufuna ukwamkela uYesu Kristu, ndicela uthethe lamazwi emva kwam ukuthi umamkele namhlanje uYesu njengenkosi nomsindisi wakho. Ithi bawo ngegama likaYesu ndiyazinikela kuwe namhlanje. Yesu Kristu, ngena ebomini bam, xolele izono zam, undenze umntana wakho, kusukela namhlanje kuze kube kunaphakade. Amen. Well, God bless you. Let's receive grace together. The grace of the Lord Jesus Christ, and the love of God the Father, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit rest and abide with you now and forevermore. And surely, goodness and mercy, good works, signs and wonders shall follow you all the days of your life, and you shall dwell in the house of the Lord, winning souls, making disciples, and planting churches forever and forever. Amen.